So carcinoid heart disease is actually a result of the carcinoid syndrome. In 95% of patients with carcinoid heart disease, they don't really have tumor in the heart. This is the effects of substances released by carcinoid tumors that affect the heart. So most commonly, we will see patients who have a neuroendocrine primary tumor. Often because of a delay in diagnosis, it has spread to the liver. And that's the key to carcinoid heart disease, because the majority of patients with carcinoid heart disease have metastases in the liver secreting substances, including especially serotonin, in high concentration and draining directly from the liver through the inferior vena cava to the right side of the heart. Yes, actually, the signs and symptoms of carcinoid heart disease are initially perhaps just the sensation of palpitations. Then if it's not diagnosed and no one listens for a murmur, you start to develop the consequences of the destruction of the right heart valves. That's the tricuspid and pulmonic. The consequences of the leaking valves is that there's a buildup of fluid in your body. So initially it starts out just as ankle edema. And then if it's not diagnosed, the edema rises up the legs. And when it reaches the level of one's waist, there develops fluid actually within the abdomen, which we call ascites. Mm-hmm. And then if it's still not diagnosed, that fluid level continues to rise. Mm. And when it reaches the level of the lungs, the patients develop fluid around the lungs, which we call pleural effusions. And then the patient starts to feel short of breath. And usually by then, some doctor says, wait a minute, there's evidence of heart failure here. Mm-hmm. And then if they do the echocardiogram, they make the diagnosis of right-sided valve involvement and the typical findings of carcinoid heart disease. Yes, the abnormal blood flow and the leaking of the pulmonic valve and the tricuspid valve characteristically causes a heart murmur. However, these murmurs are not necessarily very loud. So one's doctor could listen to your heart briefly and not actually appreciate the fact that you have a heart murmur. So sometimes they go undiagnosed for that reason. So it's not enough to say, well, my doctor didn't hear a murmur, so I don't have it. You must do the echocardiogram, because even without a murmur, if you have abnormal thickening or leaking of the valves, the echocardiogram is sensitive and they say actually specific in 100% of cases with carcinoid heart disease. It's the only test I know of that can say that. So mild leaking of the tricuspid valve is a fairly common finding, irrespective of whether or not you have carcinoid disease. So that just a mild leak of the valve alone without any thickening of the valve would not necessarily be due to carcinoid. However, if there's also thickening of the leaflets, that's the hallmark. And then I would feel confident saying that mild leak is probably carcinoid heart disease. And I would be very aggressive at that point, because we don't operate on somebody who simply has a mild leak of the tricuspid valve. We would try to get serotonin down and halt the progression of disease. We will operate if somebody has moderate or severe involvement of the valves. So usually a mild leak of the tricuspid valve would not be the answer as to what's causing fatigue. But you have to keep in mind that right heart failure is a cause of fatigue. In other words, I wouldn't overlook it. I would look for other signs of right heart failure. And the earliest sign will be swelling of one's ankles or even higher up the legs if it's not diagnosed early. So I would look for signs of right heart failure if somebody with carcinoid is complaining of fatigue. Mm. With rare exceptions, someone with carcinoid heart disease has a high concentration of metastatic tumor within the liver, secreting serotonin through the inferior vena cava up to the right heart. However, every once in a while, we will see a patient with carcinoid heart disease who has no tumor in the liver. Mm. So we have to be aware of where else could it be. And there is one location where you can have tumor secreting serotonin, which will drain into the right side of the heart, and that's from the ovaries. So someone with ovarian carcinoid could have no liver involvement, but have a high concentration of serotonin going to the right heart and causing carcinoid heart disease. Mm. That was a great question.
Yeah, great answer too.
In 1964, a researcher showed that there are three necessary components. Actually, it was Maria Spatz in 1964, showed that in the guinea pig model, the three essential components that were necessary to form carcinoid lesions are an elevated serotonin, liver involvement, and a relative tryptophan deficiency. The tryptophan deficiency is that tryptophan is the building block to form serotonin. So if you're forming a lot of serotonin, you deplete tryptophan, which is related to niacin. That's why we recommend that carcinoid syndrome patients take niacin. But with that knowledge, we were able to then focus on patients who have liver involvement with tumor, are secreting serotonin, and recognize that they're at risk of forming these lesions, and therefore we should focus on addressing the issue of serotonin, which involves reducing tumor mass and giving anti-serotonin medication, which was just this past year FDA approved. Oh, this is really an excellent question, and this comes up frequently. So the question is, if you have tumor within the liver or in the abdomen or in the bowel, very often the primary is in the small intestine, very often the terminal ileum, and you've seen a neuroendocrine tumor expert, and they've said, we're going to try to have a surgeon remove a large percentage of your tumor. And then if they do a baseline echocardiogram and they say, well, your heart has been damaged to some degree by serotonin. So what they have to determine is, does that degree of valve involvement in the heart require surgery? And if it does require surgery, your question is immediately raised. What should we do first? Fix the heart or fix the abdomen? And this is how we decide. It's actually a relative straightforward way of deciding. We do that baseline echocardiogram. And aside from looking at the heart, we also are able to look at the inferior vena cava, which is coming up to the heart. And we have a way of looking at the size and motion of the inferior vena cava with breathing to see whether the pressure in the inferior vena cava is elevated due to the heart disease. In other words, if your heart valves are leaking, that means there's an increased back pressure on the liver through the inferior vena cava. And if that pressure is high, it means that fixing something in the abdomen is going to be done at an increased risk of bleeding. Mm. So when we do the echocardiogram, we look at the inferior vena cava. If the pressure is high, we recommend fixing the heart first. Now, sometimes just giving diuretics is enough to reduce that pressure. And if we can reduce it to normal, we will then say you could go ahead and fix the abdomen first. But if that pressure remains high, despite our giving medical therapy for the heart problem, then we recommend fixing the heart first. And then 6 weeks after you're healed from your heart surgery, you can have abdominal procedures. This question raises an important issue, and that is certain types of stents require long-term anticoagulation. And when we're in a situation where fixing the carcinoid heart disease is rather urgent, then we get into the issue of selecting a certain type of stent. Usually I'm not involved in making the decision of what type of stent to recommend. I usually allow that decision to the interventionalists who do this every day. However, there is a situation in which I am involved, and that is if surgery should be performed within the next 4 weeks or so, then they use what's called bare metal stents, which require just a very short period of anticoagulation. And as soon as tissue grows over those stents, they stop anticoagulation. However, that's the unusual situation. I've been involved in a couple of cases where that's been done, but usually we use regular stents. The other thing is that if the cardiac surgeon is going to do valve surgery, he will always look at the coronary circulation so that he knows whether he should be doing a coronary bypass at the same time as he's doing valve replacement. It sure can. In fact, the hallmark is of carcinoid heart disease is a fibrosis. Fibrosis simply means scarring of the inferior vena cava, the right atrium, the right ventricle, and the pulmonary artery. In other words, the whole pathway is affected by serotonin-stimulating serotonin receptors on the inner lining of the heart, including the valves. So that was a good question. And in fact, when I give a talk on carcinoid heart disease, I show the intraoperative picture of this pearly plaque that forms, which is the scarring caused by serotonin.